Good morning. Good to see all of y'all and you folks that are watching online as well. We have a short video of our children's church going to minister to us first thing this morning, and then we'll have our first congregation. There's no one to interrupt there. All right, let's take our hymnals and turn to hymn number 198. Joy Unspeakable. Let's stand and we'll sing all four verses. Y'all sing out this morning. remain standing for prayer. Daniel, good to have you all back. You're up there. I want you to speak real loud. Would you pray for us this morning?
Heavenly Father, it's good to be in your house again today, yes. Lord. We may sing praises to your name, Lord, and read about your word and the book that you've given us through all ages, Lord. Father, may the word go deep into our heart and touch our souls, Lord. May we be obedient to your word, Father, and seek you throughout the week as we go about our business, Father. I thank you for bringing us back safely. Be with us and bless us. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Our pastor's away for a few days, so y'all got me to do the preliminaries here. I want to say it's so good to see you, Sister Betty, this morning. And I want y'all to continue to pray for Sister Betty. Brother Charles went home to be with the Lord just a few weeks ago, probably, you know, maybe 2 weeks at the most. And I'm so thankful that we know where he is. And I'm so thankful for his ministry. I thoroughly enjoyed the times that I got to sit under the teaching and preaching of Brother Charles. Very, very knowledgeable man. And I know that all that came from God working in his life. But you continue to pray for Betty. And also for the loss of her sister passed away. Pray for the extended family as well. Also, I want you to continue to pray for Wanda. Wanda, so good to have you back today. For loss of her family, please continue to pray for Wanda's family. And also, we have would like for you to pray for Pastor Moses in India. He's got surgery tomorrow, I believe it is, for the tumor on his spine. So if y'all, you prayer warriors, please continue to pray for Pastor Moses for the surgery coming up tomorrow. And also continue to pray for the Costello family. For David, lost his wife just several weeks ago. Please continue to pray for him as well. I have a card from Sister Betty I'd like to read to y'all this morning. It says, "Dear church family, for every prayer that was said, every encouraging word, every email, phone call, and text, thank you. Knowing your loved one is in a heaven place does make his passing more bearable. And all of us who know his Savior will meet Pastor Charles once again in a place where there will be no sorrow, no sickness or pain. Thank you to those who participated in and attended Charles' homecoming service and came to the family visitation. I know that he would be pleased with all that took place at his funeral. You know how he loved music, and now he's singing in the heavenly choir. Thank you, church family, also for your generous donation to one of Charles' favorite ministries, Couriers for Christ, which reaches out against violence into countries where the gospel is not welcome. We pray many will be saved because of your donation in his memory. Thank you, dear church family, for all your prayers. I love Betty. Thank you, Betty. Just a few quick announcements before we move on with the service. Primetimers, there is a correction in the bulletin. It says tomorrow, but I have a correction date of April 26th. Is that correct? April the 26th, so that's what, next Monday? At 2 p.m., and you can read the details there where it's going to be at and what have you. Sounds like fun. Sunday school teachers, don't forget we have a meeting tomorrow night, April the 19th at 6 p.m. in the fellowship hall. And we still need sponsors are needed for the Edge Camp. The Edge Camp 712 through 717. If you a married couple, you can help out with that. You can see Randy or Tina Souls about that. And don't forget about the date for our spring revival on May 16th through May 19th. And congratulations go out to David and Martha Ellenhausen. Y'all got an anniversary coming up. Martha, how did you make it this long? you got a good man there. You really do. We really and I wanted to say how much I appreciate David's challenge yesterday at the men's fellowship. it was a blessing. It really was. Talked about prayer, and it really was a blessing, David. I appreciate your ministry there. So if y'all haven't wished them a happy anniversary, y'all do so before you leave today. And Dave, you need to make sure you do something special now for Martha, okay?
Amen.
All right. I think that I'll do it for the announcements. We don't do the offering, so choir, ready to sing?
Thank you.
you so much. It's been a while since we've heard a play. That was great. Thank you so much. All right, well, welcome you to Calvary Baptist. We can get done with the choir and I get down and take off and go somewhere going, wait a minute, I gotta turn around. I'm gonna go back there and do something. I go, something's missing here. Came back up. All right. You missed a good Sunday school class this morning. I know Brother Dave talked on a few things and he brought up something that after Easter, Christ rose from the grave and how important that is and what he done. And this morning, I'm going to speak a little bit on what happened after that. Let's have a word of prayer. Lord, thank you so much for this opportunity we have once again to be here in your house. Lord, I just pray now you'll be with Pastor as he is away, studying, preparing, Lord, and comfort him. Lord, just fill him with the Holy Spirit, Lord. Fill him with the power that he needs, Lord, so that when he comes back, he'll share with us the things that you have shared with him. Be with us now this morning. I pray that through this message, you help me, Lord, with the clarity of thought that I need so I can do this, Lord. And pray and thank you so much for the love you've given us and what you've done on the cross for us. In Jesus' name, amen. If you could, turn to Acts chapter 1. I know we've gone through it in Sunday class. We've gone through Acts. Almost done. So if you want to hear the end of the story in Acts, be here next Sunday morning for Sunday school. But the last couple of weeks ago, we went through Easter. A lot of things transpired. Talking with the disciples, about the disciples this morning, a little bit about us. So after the resurrection, then what happened? Let's read Acts chapter 3, I'm sorry, chapter 1. I'm going to read verse 3 through 14 with us this morning. So listen as I read this. And this is important. Verse 3 of Acts chapter 1. To whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days, and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. And being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. But John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. When they therefore were come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, wilt thou at this time restore again the kingdom to Israel? And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons, which the Father hath put in his own power. But ye shall receive power, after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? For this same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall come in like manner as he has seen him go into heaven. You almost get goosebumps when you read that part, don't you? Then verse 12. Then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olive, which is from Jerusalem a Sabbath day's journey. And when they were come in, they went up into the upper room, where abode both Peter and James and John and Andrew and Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon Zealots, and Judas the brother of James. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the woman and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren. A lot of things happened just here in these few verses. The past month has been a whirlwind for the Lord's disciples. Just 40 days earlier, they had seen him on the cross. On On that day, all their dreams and hopes came crashing to the ground. They didn't know what to do. They hid themselves away in fear of suffering the same fate that Jesus had experienced. They were scared. But 3 days after Jesus died, he appeared to them alive again in this passage. The Lord had risen from the dead. There was hope. Still, they wavered. They were up and down. They were confused because what had just happened is not what they thought was going to happen. This is not what they had in mind. This is not what they thought Jesus was coming to do. And then all of a sudden, he left. The Lord took them aside and began to teach them some truth they desperately needed to know. Verse 3 there in the passage, he is going away. He tells them that he is leaving his work, his ministry, leaving it in their hands. So they needed to know what the Lord expected of them. And he taught them. They needed to know what they were doing, and the Lord taught them. They needed comfort for their troubled hearts at this time, and he gave it to them. In this introduction here, he spent 40 days with his men, instructing them, comforting them, spending time with them, these 40 days. After spending the 40 days with Jesus, after his resurrection, the disciples are standing with Jesus on the Mount of Olives. 40 days later, he gives them some final words of instruction. Then while they are watching him, he begins to rise up, ascending into heavens. Suddenly he is gone. He is taken from their presence, and they are left in bewilderment on the mountain without him. I mean, I read this and I go over this and I start looking up. Because that's what they were doing. You kind of want to look up to go, wouldn't that have been something to see? Oh, you're Jesus, and he's talking with you and preaching to you and helping you, and he's your friend, and you've been there for 3 years, and you left everything to follow him, and now he's here, and all of a sudden he's gone. It's like, where's he going? I mean, they should have known. In that moment, the disciples were filled with more questions than answers. Their minds are doubtless filled with many confusing thoughts. While they stand there looking up in the sky, angels, messengers from God, appear to them and say, "Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven?" The angel simply said, "What are you looking at? What are you looking at?" In other words, What has your attention? What are you focused on? Guys, what are you looking at? That's a thought I'd like to explore today with you. I want to preach on the question, what are you looking at? I want to point on some of the issues that occupied the minds of the disciples that day Jesus ascended back into heaven. Those same issues are on the mind of many of God's children today. Let's explore these issues together and hear what the Word of God has for us today. First of all, there's a compelling departure. While Jesus stands with his disciples on the Mount of Olives, instructing them to do his task and his truth, he is suddenly taken up into heaven. Gravity suddenly lost its power over Jesus. They've never seen anybody take off from the ground. Okay? And he began to ascend up into the sky until he disappeared into a cloud. This isn't a typical rain cloud that he went up into as we look up in the sky today and see clouds. The word cloud does not refer to a typical rain cloud. It refers to a glory cloud that surrounds the very presence of God. In other words, when it came time for Jesus to leave this world, his Father received him up into his Father's own glory and took him home. You're coming home, son. Took him home. After Jesus ascends into heaven, his disciples look steadfast toward heaven. Verse 10 and 11 there in the passage. They say they were gazing up into heaven. The words "look steadfastly" and "gazing" translate the same word. It means simply to fasten the eyes upon, or to look intently at something. It means that they were transfixed on Jesus as he ascended back into heaven, amazed at what was taking place. They really shouldn't have been amazed, because after all, Jesus had told them over and over what he was going to do and that that would happen. In John chapter 6, verse 62, he simply says, "What? And if ye shall see the Son of Man ascend up where he was before?" He was preaching to them in Capernaum, and they just didn't understand. They wanted signs and everything, and Jesus is trying to explain to them what was going to happen. And then again in John chapter 16, he says, "I came forth from the Father, and I am coming to the world again. I leave the world, and I go to the Father." This transfixing, looking, and gazing of the disciples into heaven speaks of more than them just standing there in amazement. It simply suggests that they were looking after him like men who were worried they had lost somebody forever. They're going like, "Where's he gone?" And they probably, blood pressure probably rose, and they're going, "He's gone. What are we going to do? He's always been with us. What's going to happen?" It suggests a look of hopeless bewilderment, of sadness, brokenhearted, astonishment. Perhaps that is why the angels that were there, they had to show up. The angels issued a mild rebuke to the disciples in verse 10. They go, "Come on, guys, why are you standing here gazing up into heaven? Like, don't you remember what he's told you to do?" For the disciples, the ascension of the Lord back into heaven changed everything. For the last 3 years, these men had spent nearly every moment they had with Jesus. They left their family, they left their friends, they left their business to follow him. Now he's gone, and they simply don't know what to do. I'm certain that the Lord's departure left the disciples confused. They did not understand completely why he left them there while he returned to his Father. They still didn't get the picture that God and Jesus was trying to teach to them 40 days before this. There's three reasons why Jesus, I want to point out, there's three reasons why Jesus had to go to heaven while his men stayed there. First reason was that Jesus had not gone away into heaven, the Spirit of God could not have come. John 16, verse 7 says, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you." So who do we have with us today? Comforter. Who's that? Holy Spirit. I mean, just knowing that he's with me keeps me going, doesn't it? These men had been walking by sight. They lived with Jesus. They heard his voice. They saw his miracles. They felt his touch. He was real. He was tangible. He was there with them. When Jesus died on the cross, the disciples were filled with fear. In John chapter 20, verse 19 simply says, "Then the same day at evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut where the disciples were assembled for fear of the Jews." They shut the door. They were fear that something would happen to them. "Jesus stood in the midst of them and said unto them, Peace be unto you." Even after the resurrection, some of them nearly quit on the Lord. Don't quit on the Lord. Just because you don't feel his presence right now or see him, don't quit on him. The disciples didn't know what to do. They were going to quit. John chapter 21, verse 3 says, "Simon Peter said unto them," to the disciples, "I go a fishing. I'm going back to what I used to do. I don't know what to do." They said unto him, well, we also go with thee. What are we going to do? Let's go back to work. They went forth and entered into a ship immediately. And the rest of the story goes that they didn't catch anything. These men were so accustomed to being with Jesus, they did not believe that they could function without him. Sometimes it's hard to try to function without knowing if God's with you or not. Sometimes you feel that he's left you. He's with you. He's just waiting for you to ask. When Jesus leaves, the Holy Spirit comes. These men will learn to what? They'll learn to walk by faith and not by sight. 2 Corinthians 5:7 tells us that. The Spirit of God will be in them to empower them for service. See, Jesus wanted to use his men to accomplish great things. One of my favorite verses in the Bible, Jeremiah 33:3. Call unto me, and I will answer thee, and show thee great and mighty things that thou knowest not. He would accomplish that through the Holy Spirit. John 14:12 says, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go to my Father. We enjoy the same blessings today. Because Jesus went away and the Spirit came, he dwells within every child of God to lead them, to guide them, to help them, to comfort them, to instruct them in the ways of God. That's what he's here to help us do, to guide us, instruct us, to help us. Jesus, number two, another way Jesus had to go to heaven. Jesus went to heaven to make intercession for us. Intercession for the disciples. When he ascended back into heaven, Jesus sat on the right hand of the Father. This is what, when he went up to heaven, this is what he did. Hebrews 1:3, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high. That's where he's at today. I can't explain how this works, but the Bible teaches us, folks, that when Jesus ascended into heaven, He took his people with him. Those who loved him, those who cared for him, those who believed him, those who have passed away here. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. When he sat down in heaven, his people sat down in heaven with him. He is there today. Why? He's there as our representative, guaranteeing that where he is, we will one day be too. One of the famous verses that I love so much today, you know, John 14:1-3. We've quoted it. You've heard in the pulpit. You've read it. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. See, we have a representative on the inside. Our Savior is in the presence of God. Where he ever lives to make intercession for us. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25 simply says, wherefore he is also able to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. That is, when sin creeps into our lives, folks, when Satan accuses us before the throne of God, saying, have you seen what Barry is doing? Have you seen what so-and-so is doing? Do you know what he said? Do you know where he's been? We have a Savior who simply says, that debt has already been paid. 1 John chapter 2. His presence in heaven is why the saints of God are eternally secure. The Savior is ever interceding with the Father. Thus, we are able now to stand, both now and later, blameless in the Father's sight. Jude chapter 1 simply says, now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. Number three, another reason why Jesus had to go to the cross, or he had to go to heaven after the cross, right? He had to ascend up in heaven and leave the disciples. Number three was, he went to heaven, I like this one, so that he could return with his people someday. Before he went to the cross, he promised that he would return for his people. Remember the verse we read, John 14, verse 3? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will what? I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you will be also. The angels at the ascension reaffirmed that promise in Acts, verse 9 through 10 here. So why stand ye gazing? He's coming back. As the scripture closes, the promise is repeated again, and even in Revelations at the end of the Bible. 22:20 simply says in that verse, Jesus is saying to us, surely I come quickly. All we've ever known is that Jesus is not here physically. I want to remind that. While he is not here with us physically, he is physically present in heaven. One day, he will return for his people to take them to heaven. You know, 1 Thessalonians, I think Brother Dave hit on this morning in Sunday school class. He goes, for the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout. I wonder what that shout's going to be. You go, hey, I'm back. Lord's going to descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Whoever comfort one another with these words. Comfort one another with these words. All you simply need to say if you want to witness to someone is just quote that verse. You know, the Lord's coming back, take us to heaven. You want to go with us? Something you got to do. One element that occupied the minds of disciples that day was the ascension of Jesus in the glory of heaven and into the presence of his Father. We would do well to meditate on his ascension and rejoice in what it really means to us. What does that mean to us? It means he's not dead. He's alive. Hallelujah. He's coming back. So a compelling departure, now a confusing for the future for the disciples. Well, Jesus is going away, the disciples are concerned about what the future holds for them and for the work of the Lord. They ask Jesus about the future and about when they can expect him to establish the kingdom of God. When are you going to establish the kingdom of God? They want to know if the time has come or if they need to wait a little bit longer. The answer the Lord gives them is anything but clear. Jesus tells them essentially that such matters are not their business, but belongs to the secret providential working of the Lord. Right? We don't know when God's coming back. Deuteronomy 29:29 says, the secret things belong to the Lord our God. The future is a secret thing, which man is preventing from knowing. So there's no so-called psychic or medium or soothsayer or prophet can tell you what happens tomorrow. But no one but God knows what the future holds or when Jesus will come for his people. Anyone who says different is simply deceiving you. While no human may know what the future holds, my friend, we know who holds the future. Our Father stands outside time. He transcends the boundaries of time and space. While we cannot see the future, the Lord is already in all of our tomorrows. He knows what's going to go on tomorrow. He has it all planned. He has it all planned for us. He has prepared our way and ordered our steps. He has. Psalms 37, 23. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way. Also in Proverbs 16, 9, simply says, a man's heart devises his way, but the Lord directeth his steps. Is the Lord directing your steps? Are you following in the footsteps that the Lord's given you? This is comforting thought, isn't it? Our world is filled with pain. Our world is filled with sorrow, with heartache. None of us know whether tomorrow will be better or worse than today. We don't know. We may not be here tomorrow. Regardless of what the path of life holds for us, our Father not only walks with us. Hebrews 13:5 says, let your conversation be without covetousness, but be content with such things as ye have. For he hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. He's not just walking with us, but he'll never leave you. You'll never have to look ahead and ask, where is that? Never have to look behind for him. He's with you. He's by your side. He also walks ahead of us. He does, to secure our future. Tomorrow is a confusing thing to us mortals. After all, we are not even promised that we'll be here, right? We don't know. Proverbs 27 verse 1 says, boast not thyself of tomorrow, for thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. We don't know. Today we are here. Tomorrow we may be in eternity. The fair winds may be blowing around us tomorrow. But tomorrow may find us in a storm of our lives. While the future may be shrouded in mystery, as far as we are concerned, we have the Lord's assurance that he is already there. He's there. He knows the trouble you're going to go through. He has the future well in hand. See, the disciples were confused and concerned about the future. But they had no need to be, because the Father had them well in hand. How about you? Are you concerned about tomorrow? Do worries, fears, and doubts trouble tomorrow? Do they trouble you? If they do, you have no need to be worried or afraid. Your Father has already taken care of your tomorrows. They're all in his hands, and so are you. He holds us in his hands. So we had a compelling departure, we had a confusing future, now we have a challenging task the disciples have to do. What is it? Another element that has the attention of the disciples that day was the assignment that they had been given. In verse 8, Jesus simply tells them what? Jesus tells them that they were to be witnesses in the world. They were to begin at Jerusalem. Then they must take the message to Judea, then the Samaria, then the uttermost parts of the world. There was a task of sharing the gospel with all the people in all places, everywhere. That's why we have missionaries on the field today. We cannot be there with them physically, but we can pray for them. We can be there with them spiritually. We can be there with them financially. We can help them in their need. We can pray for Pastor Moses, things he has to go through. This pandemic has a lot of those countries over there without vaccines. They're hurting. We need to pray for our missionaries. Their mandate was to preach the gospel to every creature. Mark 16, 15. They were to go and teach all nations. Matthew 28, 19. We know that verse. These men had a message to tell, and the Lord sent them out to tell it. The assignment must have been front and center in their minds as they watched Jesus depart from the world and disappeared into a cloud of glory. For the last 3 years, remember, the disciples had watched the Lord do what he was sending them out to do. They had heard him preach the gospel. They watched him love the lost and seen him cross all social and religious barriers to simply reach the sinners. He has used them too. He has sent them out to preach, but he had always been there when they went out and when they came back in. That's what Jesus did. Now he has gone away, and they are left behind to carry on without him. Suddenly the task they faced filled them with fear. Would me too. How would they do it without him? How could they accomplish God's work if he is not here to help them? In this text, Jesus simply reminds them that even though he is going away, he is not leaving them here to do the task alone. He hasn't left us here to do the task alone, folks. Verse 5, Jesus makes a promise to them. They said that they will be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. That promise was fulfilled 10 days later, the day of Pentecost, when the Spirit came in and power to fill the church with the power of his presence. Do you have the power of God with you today? Do you ask the Lord to fill you with his Spirit so that you can better serve him? Pastor preached on this Sunday, last, about that, being filled with the Spirit. That night before he died, the Lord Jesus promised his men that he would send them someone to help them. It said here in John 14, and I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. But ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. I will not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. That's comforting to know. I will not leave you, I will come to you. Verse 8 here, Acts chapter 1, Jesus tells the disciples simply that the Holy Ghost will empower them to carry out the mission God's leading them here to do. They will not have to do it alone. They are promised his power. They promise his touch, his blessing as they carry on the gospel to the ends of the earth. Well, we are still here. God has not changed his mind. Do you know why you're still here in this world? You are here because the Lord isn't through with you yet, folks. One reason he leaves us here in this world with all of its sins, its problems, and its pain is so that we might be witnesses to his saving grace to a world that is trapped in sin. He leaves you here so that the world might see Jesus in you. I talked about that a while back ago. Can they see Jesus in you? And so that you might tell the lost about the Christ who saves. Ye are epistles written in our hearts, knowing and read of all men, 2 Corinthians chapter 3. For as much as ye are manifested, declared to be the epistle of Christ, ministered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not in tablets of stone, but in fleshly tablets of the heart. Is in your heart. Through your heart, through your love, people will see that Christ is in you. 2 Corinthians 3 says that we are epistles. That is, we are God's letter of love and grace to a lost world. When we read our lives, when they read our lives, they should rest of his love, his mercy, and his grace of a saving power. We're like the written word of God is in our lives. Remember, know the verses. Know what to say. Know how to act. Know how to talk to the lost. That is why we should live for him and why we should always be ready to share the gospel with a lost world. But sanctify, 1 Peter 3, but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and be ready. How often? Always. Be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. That's why we're here. I'm sure the task laid upon and occupied the minds of the disciples that day. I fear, however, that the task rarely crossed our minds today. We have the same assignment today, folks. May the Lord help us to be about our Father's business. So not only was it a compelling departure, a confusing future they had, but the challenging task that God gave them. But now we have a comforting promise. There's a promise. The minds of the disciples are filled with many thoughts. They have been given an assignment that far exceeds their abilities. They face a future that is unknown and probably a little more than frightening to them. And to top it all off, they have just watched as their Savior, the Lord, the one that they had left everything behind and followed him for 3 years, disappeared into a cloud of glory. They're terrified and filled with many questions about today and about all the tomorrow that lay ahead. They're so captivated, though, by the sight of Jesus going into heaven here that they obviously didn't see the two strangers who appeared on the Mount of Olives beside them. These men who turn out to be angels, they speak words of comfort to the confusing disciples. The angels simply tell them, "The same Jesus, which is taken from you into heaven, shall come again in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven." So how is Jesus going to come? In like manner as he left, in a cloud of glory. That's going to be an amazing sight. Where's it going to be? Is it going to be in the same place? I don't know. I don't care. He's going to come. We're all going to see him at the same time. The angels simply tell them, they say yes. They say, it's like, yes, he has gone away, but there is no use staring into heaven with a sense of confused bewilderment, guys. Jesus has gone away, but he's coming again. So get on with the business he left you to do. The angels are saying, why are we here? Don't you remember what God has told you to do? The implication is clear. The angels tell them that he's to be about the business of the Lord, knowing that as they work for him and serve him, there's coming a day when he will return. I've already referred to it, but this is the same assurance that we live under today, folks. While the future unfolds around us with all of its uncertainties and questions, and while our lives are occupied with serving him, we have a blessed confidence that Jesus is coming again to claim his people. Never forget that. John 14, 1 through 3 simply told us that. He promised he's coming back. Prepare a mansion for you. And if I do, I will come again and receive you under myself for where I am. There you will be also. One day Jesus will come for you, and he will take you home to live with him forever in heaven. That is why Paul referred to the Lord's coming as a blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. So no matter what today holds, my friend, or what tomorrow brings your way, you can rest in the knowledge that Jesus is coming. If you know him as your Savior, that day will be a day of wonder, blessing, and glory. Can't wait. Can't wait. In conclusion here, if you're looking at today, what has your attention? Why are you occupied? And what are you occupied with today? Are you caught up in the wonder of a risen Savior who loves you and who gave himself for you on the cross of Calvary? Are you caught up in that? You should be. If you're caught up with Jesus in his glory, that's a wonderful thing. It means that you are saved and will be ready to meet Jesus when he comes again. Are you confused about the turns life has taken us and taken you? Many things have changed in our lives since we were younger. Many things can still change in our lives. Are you worried over the future and what holds for you? If you're worried about today or tomorrow, I challenge you to leave that in the hands of the Lord. He has you today, and He has you all tomorrow. He knows your tomorrow. He knows it well in hand. Bring your fears to Him and let Him comfort your heart. I encourage you this morning, let Jesus simply comfort you. Trust in Him as your Savior. Are you actively serving the Lord and doing the work of sharing the gospel with others? As He said that we needed to do, told the disciples? If you are serving the Lord and sharing Him with the lost, carry on. That's what we need to do. One day He is coming and He will reward you for your faithful service to Him. Are you looking for His coming? Are you ready for Him, for His return? If you are looking for Him, don't stop. He's coming. Don't stop. If you, my friend, are uncertain about if He's coming for you, He's coming, my friend. He's coming to take those who love Him. He's coming to take those who have accepted Him as their personal Savior, who believe in Him and believe that He died on the cross and believe what the Bible says and believe about how God has helped them. He's coming to take the believers to heaven. If you're not sure if you're a believer this morning, if you don't know without a shadow of a doubt if He's preparing that mansion for you, if you don't know, if you're uncertain one little iota about that, you need to make that today. You need to decide, you need to make that assurance today, my friend. Because tomorrow, Jesus knows what's going to happen tomorrow. Are you going to be here when that happens? Or are you going to be gone? What's going to happen tomorrow? As we stand this morning, and as I'm going to ask Brother Gary to come up and lead us in the invitation, I'm going to ask Brother Dave to come up and stand right up here in front. As we sing the invitation, come on up, men. As we sing the invitation this morning, if you're not saved, if you don't know if you're on your way to heaven, you need to make sure you're saved. You need to make sure that you're going to be there. So, again, I ask, what are you looking at? What are you looking at? What is it you need? You need Christ in your heart. If you don't have Christ in your heart, you need that today. Lord, thank You for the service. Pray now that as they do the invitation, Lord, that You'll work in our hearts. Thank You so much for what You've done on the cross. Help us to carry on, Lord. Help us not to stand here gazing upon what You did, but help us to be thankful for what You did and help us to carry on the message You have left here for us to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's all stand as we sing.
Take our hymnals and turn to hymn number 280. Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Invitation is for all. It's for the saved, it's for the unsaved. We as believers, is our life of late been one of a lack of grace and mercy toward others? Has it been taking a blind eye to those that are in need of a Savior? A blind eye to opportunities that God gives us to be a witness to others? A blind eye of having the right attitude that others see Christ in us? If that's you today, you need to come and do business with the Lord here at this altar. And as Brother Barry has already said, if you're unsure, there's any doubt, you can come down this aisle and ask the Lord to forgive you of your sin, and He will. He will do that, and He will save you. You can talk to Brother David. He can take this side room here in just a few minutes with the Word of God and show you how you can be saved and know 100% for sure when you leave here today. Where are you going to go if you were to die tomorrow? So whatever the need, you come as we sing softly and tenderly.
Oh,
63, and we'll just sing that first verse, a good song to end up, especially all the that know the Lord as your personal Savior. What a day that's going to be. Thank you and we praise you and give you all the glory and honor for it all in your precious name. Amen.